Hey guys, my name is Vijay and I'm from Singapore. We have a bar called Native, and super glad that you guys could be here so that I can share with you a little bit more about what we do and more importantly, why we do what we do. So this is us. We've been open for about 3 years now, and it's been a very nice journey. So the bar is open by myself and a couple of childhood buddies of mine. So, you know, all the savings, credit cards, bank loans all jumped in. And we never thought that people will actually like what we do. But in the last 3 years, the reception has been fantastic. And hopefully we can do a little bit more. So this is the bar, basically. We're in Amoy Street, which is right smack in the central business district of Singapore. And when you walk in, the bar is going to be slightly different from what you're used to. If you look at the back bar, you know, you won't see any of like your common spirits. The whole idea behind what we do is working with local and regional produce and craftsmen. And the values that we try to focus on is work with flavors that are unique to us, that grow around us, and the people who make these stuff. So when you look at the back bar, you will see things like, you know, Singapore gins, Indian whiskey, Arak from the region, and that's the whole idea, to work closer to a radius from where we are. So we're in a very iconic space, which is a shop house. So these shop houses, they have been around for about 200 over years. And if you look at the design, like the beams, the brick walls, the flooring, they were all the original in-state. And very iconic to the space as well is Amoy Street used to be the area where early settlers would come to Singapore and do trading. So our shop house used to be a trading shop house and then eventually became an opium den. And then now it's a cocktail bar. This is our logo. One of my very good friends helped us design it. So if you look at the letters like N-T-I-V-E, they're actually all based from a fragment of a stone. It's called the Singapore stone. So it's a fragment with like our indigenous language based on it. But till today, no one can really decipher the full meaning. But the letters are based off this stone, like N-T-I-V-E. And the A is actually an international glyph for explore. So the whole idea is to be local, but with our ideas, like reach globally. A little more closer look of what we look like. So we have a one-piece bar that was hand-sculpted. And the idea behind the bar was, obviously, since this was an area for trading early in the day, the bar is actually in the shape of a one-piece ship. And the copper is actually meant to be the ripples. So the idea is like on a busy day, if we can't serve everybody, hopefully whoever we serve, our ideas and hospitality travels and ripples through them. Some of the spirits that we work with, and later on we'll look a bit more closely with them. It's quite exciting because when we first opened the bar 3 years ago, we had this idea of what we wanted to do, but we really didn't know what was out there. And when we started the bar, we only had like 10 to 12 bottles on the back bar. And now the entire shelves are full. And when we have a new product, we have to find a space for it. And that's because in the last 3.5 to 5 years, especially in Singapore and Asia throughout, there's been so many craft distillers popping up. And there's good reason for it because, you know, there's the highest amount of sugarcane in like the Philippines and India, and they're the highest drinkers of like rum. So it only makes sense that all these spirits are turning into craft spirits and smaller distillers, be it the locals or people who have moved over to that side of the world, start producing it. So we're starting to get really quality, like, you know, whiskies from India, Taiwan. We've got three local gin distilleries with four different expressions. Next week, we're going to have a local rum maker launching their product as well. So it's very, very exciting. One of the distilleries that we personally like to work very close to is these guys, Compendium Liquids. So it's very interesting because they started making mead, which is like honey wine. And then after that, they started producing a gin from that mead, the honey ferment. So they were distilling honey as a base and then adding things like juniper, native ingredients like ginger flower, different kind of local citruses as well. And they also have another gin based on like palm sugar, so like coconut sugar distilled as a base and then pandan, juniper and coconut And these are the guys that are releasing the rum next week as well. So a lot of things are happening. And the distillery is about a quarter of a size of this hall. And they're doing some really cool stuff. And they're producing liqueurs. And I think they've got an absinthe on the way as well. So it's just really interesting to see like small budget. It's a two-man team creating spirits with a lot of flavor. Some of the ingredients that we work with, we get a lot of different kind of like palm, coconut, different variations of sugar, different flavors as well. A lot of tropical fruits like pink dragon fruits. On top over there, that little root, it's called Tongkat Ali. So it's a native root, and you can even forage it as well. It sort of looks like a ginger, but it's very medicinal in purpose. And if you take it just by itself, it's meant to be like an aphrodisiac, a sort of a natural sort of Viagra. And we had it in one of the cocktails called the Red Light District, a small little tincture in there. We get a lot of good cinnamon, wild cinnamon as well. A lot of different single origin coffee popping up that we try to work with. So just going into our cocktails, when we first started the bar, you know, we had this idea of what we wanted to do, working with local, regional produce, craftsmen as well. But the idea when it came down to the cocktail was like, how are we going to execute these cocktails? Might just taking this spirit and then mixing up into classics, would it really represent that element? So we actually don't do any classics at the bar. We work a little bit backwards. We find the craft people, we look at tradition, we look at ingredients, we look at wild herbs, and then we try to put these flavors together in a cocktail. So for example, this cocktail is actually based off a local group of people. They're called the Peranakans. So the Peranakans are a very diverse mix of different cultures and flavors, and they've been in Singapore for like since the 1600s, and a lot of the ingredients that they use are only unique to their culture. So this one's based off one of the desserts. It's called a kueh salad, so kueh meaning dessert. So we explore those flavors. We get wild jackfruit. We get candle nuts. So these are called candle nuts. They look like a macadamia, but locally they're known as bois caras. And they have this slightly sort of bitter, really oily, rich flavor to it. And they add it to curries for thickness and for flavors. And we infuse pandan, palm sugar. We also source a locally used goat's milk in the cocktail. But it's quite interesting because the enzyme in the jackfruit ends up splitting the milk. So when we strain it, we get a crystal clear cocktail. And then the leftover curds, we mix it back into the jelly garnish, with a bit of coconut and pandan. And then up top, we have the jackfruit seeds. So naturally, like my grandmas and those generations, they used to boil it or roast the jackfruit seeds after eating the jackfruit, and they had this real nutty flavor. So we just grated over the cocktail. So I guess we look at cocktails in a very different way. Like you could look at tradition and you can look at flavors, ingredients, instead of just always using a template and building upon it. And also, if you look at our cocktails, each one of it is very mindful, and we try to use as much of the ingredients as we can. So for this one, you know, the curd goes back in the jelly, the seeds goes as a little garnish. This one's another one that we do. It's one of our best sellers since we've opened. It's called the pineapple arak. So we get a coconut arak from Sri Lanka. And to me, right now, arak is a very interesting spirit because different parts of the world, they make it very differently. Most people might know like things like raki or arak from the Middle East, you know, which is more of like an anise-flavored spirit. And then you come down to Sri Lanka, India, primarily it's made from coconut or palm. And I think Indonesia is the most interesting one because different states, they produce arak differently, sometimes from rice, sometimes from molasses, sometimes from honey, and sometimes it could even be a blend. So it's very much like a terroir spirit, like where you are is how they make it. So whatever raw materials they have or whatever's popular in that part is what they use. And this one's a coconut arak. We went to visit the distillery last year, and it's like phenomenal. It's like probably one of the most eco-friendly distilleries that has been around since the late 1800s. They get coconut flour, which is the sap. So a guy climbs up the tree, and then he collects the sap every morning. And it's naturally fermented as well, because it's super rich in natural sugars that it ferments up in the air. and they leave it for now 24 hours. And by that time, you have coconut wine for about 7 to 10%. And they distill that, which becomes the spirit, and it gets aged for about 5 to 7 years in a Sri Lankan wood. And the leftover sludge from the distillation, they actually use like just gravity, and they sort of push it all the way like 500 meters away from the still, and they create like methane to power up the stills. And the leftover from that production is this like black sludge that looks like Vegemite or Marmite. They just dig a hole, they put it in the ground, and it's really rich in a lot of minerals. So, and when the rain comes in, now they have a pond, and turtles come in and lay eggs, and it's crazy. So once again, you know, we have this spirit, and like, what are we thinking when we are coming up with a cocktail? So our idea is like, okay, this comes from coconut. Why not just use entire coconuts in the cocktail? So we use coconut water, we use coconut oil, we use coconut flesh, we use the coconut husk in an entire infusion. And now we work with organic spice farmers from Sri Lanka. So we get organic cinnamon, cardamom, black pepper, cloves. We do an entire infusion overnight. We strain the entire cocktail, and we just infuse some pineapple skins in there. Because the skins, you know, they still have a lot of flavor. And the leftover pineapples, we oven bake with some cinnamon as a little garnish. So skins has a primary flavor, and then the pineapple as a garnish. And that leftover pulp that we get from the cocktail, what we're doing right now is we dry it, we blend it with beeswax, and then we use it for candles for like our toilet. Another one of our cocktails that we use oysters in one of our newer cocktails. I guess traditionally, like where we're from in Singapore, in our local cuisine, we don't really have like oysters fresh. How we normally have it is like in an oyster omelette in a huge pan. It gets stir-fried. So when we found some local farmers growing some amazing quality oysters, that was the idea we had. So this cocktail is based off like the oyster omelette that we have. So we distill. We've got a small little rotovap, so we do like a distillate with the oysters. And then for the eggs, what we do is we cure the yolks in miso. And then the egg whites, we fry it, like stir fry it, and then we blend it into a savory foam. We've got some rice wine, calamansi, which is local citrus, palm sugar, and a bit of salt. And the calamansi, which is looks like a small green lime, but it's a bit sweeter. The shells, what we do is we blend it with koji, a little bit of salt and sugar, and then we make the miso for the eggs that we can cure. And the shells, we do a few things as well. One is we cure the shells in an acid solution for a month. So what happens is it dissolves, and then that we use as a little acidity into the cocktail. And the leftover shells, we actually worked with a local ceramic maker, and then we blended it into the ceramic cups. And the last bit, the ceramic maker, she has this oven that goes up to like 1,004 degrees. We burn the shells, and it breaks down the components, and then we add it to our compost. And then we grow the microgreens on that compost, which goes back into this cocktail. So another one we have called the concrete jungle. I guess if you guys been to Singapore, you know, we're a tiny little like island, state, country, everything, originally 60 by 40 km. So we are in a very amazing climate, a temperament climate by the equator line. We have a lot of things that grow. So I like to use the word like urban foraging when we go out to collect some ingredients. But we don't have a lot of everything. So we get a lot of variety, but we don't really get necessarily the amount. You know, we're not going to get 20 kgs of berries every summer. And besides, it's summer every day in Singapore as well. It's always warm. So we have to think of different ways that I'd like to share with you guys later on. But this is one of the cocktails that's based on like our urban foraging. We get wild ginger flowers, these guys over there. So we have 47 different types of gingers just in Southeast Asia alone. I'm still learning. I only know about 12 to 13. And this is one of the variants where the flowers, or we call it the rojak flower, is used very much in our cuisine. So we do a distillate with that, and we get some nutmeg leaves as well. These are the leaves of a nutmeg. They have a very similar flavor with nutmeg, just a bit more grassiness. We do a distillate with that. We add a locally made mead. In the cocktail, and we collect some spring water. And this spring water is like really cool because it's not the most beautiful like spring-looking area. You actually have to pump it out of the ground, and it's warm. And when you smell it, it smells like raw eggs because of the sulfur content. So it's super high in minerals. But once we let it rest for a week, the smell actually disappears, but the minerality stays. So we add it into the cocktail as a little mineral flavor, the concrete element. And then we get some pepper leaves over here. We dry it, and then we sprinkle it with a bit of bee pollen and another form of ginger called temulawak. It looks like turmeric, but it's a lot more medicinal, and it's been used in medicinal qualities for a long time. No slide? All right. So a bit more close up to what we do. The leaves, we actually fry it, dry it, and then the bee pollen and temulawak. So these leaves are quite interesting because the flavor profile is quite similar to like a betel leaf, but these grow on the floor. They don't grow in vines, and it's everywhere, like in the forest, it's everywhere. So we collect about 200 to 250 of these leaves every week. So once again, you know, we try to do a bit of urban foraging, but we don't get a lot of quantity. So we look at different ways where we can use it. And when we think of like urban foraging, we don't really think of the idea of like, okay, it has to be this ingredient that's plucked from this tree and into your cocktail. But the way we think about it more is like, how can we include that element? Because there's so many things around us, you know, it's not just trees and leaves, like there's so many things floating in the air. And then we got some wild turmeric, and what we did was we made it into like a E starter. So over here. So it's just we grated the turmeric, a little bit of water and sugar, and 2 days later it becomes this fizzy little starter, and then we use that as a starter to ferment coconut water, and then that goes into the cocktail. So some things that we think about is like, how can we take like small flavors and then just enlarge it and use it for bigger batches. And other things that we do as well, we make teas, and then we make like kombuchas, which ends up in our cocktails or our non-alcoholic option, distillates, hydrosols are just a few of the things that we do. Okay, so I guess at our bar, we try to be a bit more responsible as well. I guess the word being thrown around these days is sustainability. But 3 years into trying to be a bit more responsible in the bar, it's really hard. I'd like to share with you guys a few things that we do, and also after that share with you the things that we're struggling with, and hopefully, you know, we can work as a community to push these things forward. So some of the things that we do is like we do our own composting, which is quite simple. We use a very basic setup. It's not very fancy. It's a pail with a couple of holes drilled for aeration. We put our food waste in there, and then we use lotus leaves as our coasters, and they last about 10 to 15 times, and after which we just drop it in, and then we get leftover coffee pulp from the local baristas, and we get coconut husk, and then we just churn it every week, and after about like 3 to 4 months, we have this compost, and that's what we start growing like microgreens and little herbs from. But before we compost it, we spray an enzyme. It's called like bokashi. It's this little powder. You spray it on, and you get to collect this little liquid over here. And this, it's sort of like almost like a vinegar, but not as intense. And you can use it to like sanitize the venue, mop the floors, and wipe the windows, which is what we do. And then obviously, I guess in 2019, nobody uses plastic straws anymore for a very good reason. This is our apron. It's not as the one I'm wearing doesn't look as fresh as the ones over here, but we actually worked with our apron maker for a year, and he actually collected our food waste, and then he dyed it with our food waste. So like all the flour infusions that we had left over, we dried it and we kept it aside, and then dyed it blue. And then these little pouches are actually like bed sheets that have been thrown away by a hotel. And then we dyed it with some wild mango leaves. And these were like leftover textiles from our apron maker. And then he did like a little patchwork. So each one of us has a different sort of pocket. And we've used it for a while now, so we're thinking of sending it back to him and see whether we could change up the colors, change up the pouches, see what we can do with it. So we have a very tiny like garden space just nearby the bar. So we do our composting. And it's very important because when we first started doing our composting, you know, everything just went into the compost. So it was we had to realize that, okay, the compost had to be relative to the stuff that we are growing and bringing it back to the bar. If not, we would just have too much compost and it would be just stored and not doing anything. So before it goes into the compost, we have this rule that it has to be like, you know, explored to its full extent. You know, it has to be made into a powder. We could use it for seasoning for snacks, or we could make like kombuchas from it, or we could use it for like food dyes. And then finally it goes into compost, and then we start growing things like we got turmeric leaves over here, leaves of a turmeric. This is sawtooth coriander, curry leaves, and we try to bring that element back into the bar. Yeah, and I guess we do quite a few things as well. Like the bar is entirely powered by solar right now. We've changed all our bulbs to LED bulbs that help a lot. We do a lot of our own like sous vide infusions as well, but we don't use the vac packs. We just use like glass jars. And to me, the infusions are as good. And the leftover sous vide water every night, what we do is we use it to mop the floor. That water gets used to wash the toilets. And if you ever come to the bar, we actually have a mural that we're working with the local artist, and he's collecting our food waste, and he's starting to paint things from our food waste, making it into colors. So this is some of the things that we do as well. And I guess the idea of trying to be responsible or sustainable doesn't really stop there. We try to push it into our staff as well. You know, we've got a little savings account where we save for the team, and you know, whoever has been with us for more than 1.5 years, they get to choose to go to do a stage wherever they want. So we've sent our team to do trainings at like Empirical. One of our staff recently went to do a training in CUP in London. So we try to think about that as well. And recently we've done, every quarter we're doing, we got a physio that comes in, and then we do like stretching and stretching exercises and all that stuff, because you know, bartenders, we ache everywhere. And then this person's also on call, so you could message her and like, oh, my neck's hurting, my elbow. So we try to do all that small stuff for our team. And also like I'll pass some stuff around. This is our coasters, and this is our compost. You can see what happens. The compost is dried because I had to bring it with me to travel. But otherwise, it's quite moist. And then this is another one that we are working on. So like these are basic cloths that we use to wipe our tables and stuff. And then after which we sterilize them, dye them with turmeric. And then now we can use it for like wraps, like food wraps. And instead of using like cling wraps and stuff, you could wrap your leftover citrus, and the wax sort of holds it into position. So it's quite a new sort of thing that we're working on. And I think, I think that's about it from me. I can't think of anything else. Thank you guys for joining me today, and I hope to see you guys at Singapore at the bar one day and serve you guys. Cheers. Thanks.
If you guys have any questions for Vijay, he's here and happy to answer them for you as well.
You were saying that because you're near the equator, you literally don't have change of seasons. Is that true? Like this?
We have very like small micro seasons, but I guess we don't really realize it. It could be like 26 to 28 degrees, and like you have more fruiting seasons more than like winter, autumn, fall, summer.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hi, Vijay. Our industry is very a luxury business. There's a lot of brands, big brands, sponsoring a lot of things we're doing, traveling, eating, drinking.
Yep.
And your bar is actually, it's just craft. no big brands, no nothing. There's any conflicts in that, or it's just like it's okay?
It's tough. We're broke, so we don't really get much financial support from brands in the bar. But I think it's what we want to do, and also like the brands that we work with, they're really small scale, the economies of scale. So when we get the spirits as well, you know, the price point's a little higher as well. So we work around ways, and I think we're in it for the long haul, in that if we support these spirits now, and hopefully one day when they're big and they have the scale, you know, they'll support us. But it's been nice working with the smaller distilleries, because same thing, you know, like I think I forgot to touch upon like what we're struggling with at the bar when it comes to the idea of sustainability. I guess, you know, sometimes you still have glass bottles and you're just recycling them. It's not the best possible option. But working with the smaller distilleries, you know, that are so close to you, they pass you the spirit, you finish it up, you pass it back to them, and it's just a nice little circle that we have. Sometimes, no matter what, I mean, we still just get plastics coming through the bar. And it's tricky because, you know, it's everywhere, like on the bottle, like when you get a new bottle, you know, it could be on the wrap and just small little things, and it adds up. So that's what we're struggling with as well. Singapore's warm, so we use air cons. So that's tricky. That's a lot of power. Although we have, we use like solar, it doesn't really like go to the full usage as well. We still have ice. Ice production takes up a lot of energy. So I hope in the next few years that we can try to work on these elements. And also, I think in the industry, you know, we are not alone. Everybody's like pushing towards one direction.
Another question, actually. We have a lot of, especially probably in Singapore, there's a lot of global guests that travel a lot from different parts of the world, coming and visiting your bar, expecting some, for example, the brands they love. They say, do you have this agave spirit, this tequila, or this mezcal? And they say, you say, no, we don't have it. And then, do you have any like difficulties to say no constantly? Or
I think we do have some people that obviously are a little bit more difficult than the rest, but we've started that way. So I think people, when they come in, you know, and we're in the second floor, we're not in the front edge, we're nice and cozy. So a lot of times, before people come in, they have an understanding of what we do. But still, we have a bit of a, once in a while, a bit of a challenge of people who come in and they're like, I want a Negroni. And you're like, we don't have it, you know. But if someone wants a bit like an old-fashioned, or someone wants a bitter flavor, or someone wants a smoky flavor, we try to sort of guide them to a cocktail. And if someone wants a mezcal, I'll say, I don't have it, but you know, I have something a bit more interesting. If you look at the menu, a lot of the spirits might not be familiar. So maybe I could recommend you something based on flavor instead of like a spirit. And we try our best. Yeah, but most of the time, our customers are pretty open-minded. But once in a while, we have a few difficult customers, yeah.
Hey, Vijay.
Hey.
I got a bunch of questions for you.
Okay.
So, I mean, first off, is sustainability, responsibility, it's very fashionable, very trendy at the moment. Is this, I mean, are you the forefront of something that's going to get bigger and bigger? Or is it going to be like molecular mixology and other things that were fashionable for a bit and then die away? I mean, do you see yourself as being part of the future or just a bright spark?
I think for us, you know, I always say, like, first of all, we're a bar that focuses on like local and regional produce. That's our thing. And then the idea of being responsible is just, it's just normal. We all just have to start doing it, you know. And I don't think it's a fashion. I just think the way we're going to look into it, is it going to be a little bit more healthy and organic instead of, oh, we're a trend. We're, you should buy this because it's sustainable. And of course, we've seen in the last 1.5 years a lot of people coming in and jumping into it and trying to make money out of it. But like I always say, the customers are the smartest people out there. They'll smell if you're trying to do it just for marketing, and compared to whether you're honest about it or not. Yeah. So I think it's here to stay, just that the ways we're doing it. And you know, all of us, we run different styles of bars, and like what we do at Native might not necessarily be the best for like a high volume bar. What they do might not be the best for us. But I think we've started a conversation, and even if it's a little bit or a full amount, I do think that we're going to see a lot more bars and restaurants starting to do more. Yeah.
Okay. And obviously, I mean, you're a visionary, which is why I asked you to be here, etc. I mean, who are the other bars and who are the other bartenders around the world that you keep an eye on what they're doing, or are you in contact with people who are doing similar things to be sharing ideas? I mean, who do you look to?
Yeah.
For
I think 2016 when I did like a training at White Lion, that was really cool. That was what got me thinking, because there was no trash to take out. You know, I felt good. I didn't have like sludge and trash, and I didn't have to slug it over the bin. So that was a real start. So obviously those guys were doing it, like when you mentioned it wasn't a statement or it wasn't fashionable. Obviously the guys at Himcock on a huge level, they do lots of cool stuff. So very, very inspirational stuff. I think these are a few of the guys, you know, that we have a conversation most of the time, and I look up to as well, yeah.
But also, I mean, what are the resources that exist? I mean, are you making it up and trial and error to start off with? Or are there websites or books that don't give you all the answers but you use as text to refer back to?
I think there's a few things. When we first started the composting system, it was a mess. Like, it wasn't really working, because all we did was put food waste and we churned it, and it'll come to like this wet sort of compost smelling ingredient. And then we realized like there's this whole idea between greens and browns. So like food waste is considered greens, and like things like coconut husk, rice hulls, paper, cardboard, leaves, they're considered browns, and it's all about balancing. So if you add one part green, you need four parts of brown. So like for the first 6 months we had compost, but it was just super high in nitrogen and like sticky, and then we learned it out as we go. And my team is like out of this world. They're always finding different things that we can use. And we have someone who's in charge of this, Michelle. So it's in her blood, you know. So she's one of those people walking around with her own tote bag, coffee mug, and metal straws, everything in there. So she's always looking out for new things as well. And something that we're trying in the bar, we're not very successful, is we're experimenting with a bit of bioplastics. So using things like seaweed and food waste and trying to create things. But the trickiest part is, you know, it's we don't have enough information about all these things. And like, we have a lot of data coming in of a lot of different companies saying different things, you know, like, oh, your tote bag is worse than a plastic bag or takes up more energy. So I think the whole world for us, you know, it's so new. It shouldn't be, but it's so new for us. So the next few years, I do see a lot more educational resources popping up, sharing notes, and hopefully a better community as well.
Okay. But also, I mean, what's it done for your creativity with a whole range of products that you don't have and things like that? I mean, was it something you had to teach the bartenders, or was it something that they literally, you know, adapted?
I think it's something I had to learn myself first, you know. Like, I've been bartending for about 10 years, and I've 12 years now. The first 10 years, I've always worked in sort of like international bars towards international sort of flavors. And then it came to a point where I didn't even know things that, you know, like my grandparents used to use or my mom uses so comfortably, and I'm not even sure of it. So it was a lot of backtracking and looking into a tradition. And like what you mentioned, like, I think having less, you know, it just boosts like your creativity a lot more, because you're not used to like, okay, I need this bitter flavor, I'm gonna hop on for Amaro, I'm gonna use bitters, but then you start to use like different techniques like kombuchas, distillation, vinegars, you know, reductions, and you try to blend that together. I think it really expands the idea of like creativity, and it helps us, it helps our team as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think the idea that on one hand this is cutting edge, but on the other hand it is things that our grandparents did, because you didn't waste and you didn't have product all year round, so you had to make do with what you had, etc. So has your grandmother been useful in this process?
Yeah, I think it's been awesome. And like going back into the markets, asking them how they use certain ingredients. And back in Singapore as well, you know, we have so many microcultures. But as a city, we've moved so fast that, you know, sometimes some microcultures are getting forgotten. Like you have the local Eurasians, they're called the Kristangs. You know, no one really talks about them, but they've been in the city since the 1500s. You talk about the Peranakan people, obviously we've seen a surge, and thankfully that's kept the culture alive. My grandma was like an Indian Peranakan, they call them Chiti Malakans, you know, so not a lot of people know about this, and I think that's what it's very important to us at the bar. It's like not just making cocktails, but when someone walks out, you know, can we share like a story, and most importantly, can we be honest about what we're doing and try to connect with people based on that? Yeah.
Do you have any other questions? Yeah.
Don't be scared. I know Vijay very well. Just now you're talking about, Eric asked the question about, you know, do you find it difficult maybe explaining to people? So I want to just ask a little bit about education. Mm-mm. So first, there's two parts. So one is education of the consumer. Mm. And then second is you have a very good young team, but, you know, they could be working for, you know, someone else who's maybe flashier and has more money or more, you know, sponsors.
Yeah.
Backing all this. So how do you find them? How do you train them? How do you keep them?
Yeah. So, I mean, as a bar, you know, naturally we have things that we struggle with. But one thing I'm quite lucky is we've always got, like, amazing people. And it usually comes from, like, someone sends their resume and they just walk right in. We do a trial shift and we just kick-started from there. We've got an amazing team, mostly youngsters below 25, and they've all grown so quickly. And for us, it's the best when someone has no experience, because then, you know, we're doing something different, we can kick off. But we've had a lot of bartenders who've had experience, and obviously in the first stages, it's like, okay, we should do this, you know, like classics, and like, okay, why not just look at it from a blank canvas? And in about 2 to 3 months, you know, they start to see things differently, and it's been really organic. And one thing I'm super proud of my team is they really go the extra mile. You see them come early, like 1 hour, just doing R&D by themselves. You know, you see them like pull up their sleeves before shift and like churning compost. And I'm super proud of them. And in the beginning, I think one of the challenges that we had was getting female staff, you know, and that was always affecting me. And then now we've got about 4 to 5 female staff, you know. 3 of them, they're part-timers, 2 of them on R&D. You won't see them on shift, but they're there. So it's also growing, which is what I'm quite happy about. So, yeah.
Okay. And then just the education of the consumer side. So you're saying, you know, so one people thing, are open-minded, but I mean, still, there's a lot that
one thing
get.
That we do is, like, if any of you have been to the bar, like, everybody who gets their drink, like, how I spoke to you guys about the cocktails, they get the exact same thing. On a Friday night, it's full house. Everybody gets to know how their cocktail was made, why it was made, what culture was it inspired by, what ingredients. And we have a lot of people traveling through, and they don't know any of these, like, ingredients. It's all foreign to them. So we take it out, either dried or preserved, and show them what it's like. And then at the end of it, they get a little tour as well on our attic space, and then they get to see how we actually extract ingredients, put it into the cocktail, and then if there's some time, usually we go through our composting process, we show people our compost, and then show them the microgreens that we grow as well. So I think it's very important that everybody gets that level of service from me, because they might not like the drink, that's okay with me, but they have to know what was the reason and the ideas behind it.
Hello. Hey, I was wondering, so I live in Colombia. What do you think are some challenges of sustainability in tropical countries versus, say, Europe or the US? Because a lot of the sustainability seminars you go to are with bartenders who work in New York or London, dealing with different challenges. What for you have been some challenges working with sustainability in a tropical country?
Sustainability for us, I think certain things are a bit confusing for me. Like, obviously, recycling is not the best way out there, but it's a better solution than just not recycling. And back home, you know, it costs like $40 to $50 extra just to get the company to come and recycle your glasses. And people don't want to do it just because it's like $50 extra, but they will get a new marble top table or something in chrome or the latest spirits that are way more expensive than that amount. So that's a little confusing to me. And in Singapore, where I'm from, it's very convenient. You get everything. Everything's 24 hours. You make a call and it's there and everybody's super helpful. But that also sort of limits us because then people get things too easy and they don't want to work harder. They don't want to bring their own bags to the groceries because the plastic bags are there. If you charge them, people get angry. And for me, for 3 years of having the bar, one thing I think that every bar just should have because it's super simple is just have your own composting system. It's not as complicated as it sounds. All you need is a pail, drill some holes, cover it up, and put your food waste and churn it manually. That's 1.0. Obviously, there's high-tech like composting systems where it's a 24-hour composting system, but it'll cost you like a five-digit. But I think that's one thing hopefully we see people do a bit more. And I guess another thing is not just in tropical countries or Asia, it's like because customers are so used to having something, sometimes it's a bit hard to say like, oh, there's no straw in your highball, you know? So people are like, oh, people want the plastic straws, or customers complain about the metal straws, it's too cold, it affects, hurts their teeth or something like that. So I think just maybe being a bit more brave about it and sometimes saying no.
Right, any other questions?
Very simply, what was your biggest success? The one thing that you've done that you were most happy with or made the most difference?
Yeah.
Your biggest mistake? The thing that, you know, just stressed you out? And what one thing would make everything you're doing just that little bit easier?
I think the thing that made me, like, till this day, like, the thing that made me the happiest was, like, the first day we opened the bar. Because I was down and out, you know. There was one day I had, like, $2 in my pocket. My fiance at the bar just cement. I'm like, we're messed. Like, we're messed. I'm not sure how we're going to do it. So, you know, like, we're starting to see a bit more of it, but, you know, owner-operator bars, you know, for me growing up, that wasn't even a possibility. It's always like you had to work under a big company, and if you're lucky, you had a small share in the upcoming project. So that's something that will always make me happy. And the fact that people just like what we do, you know, and it's totally different. Mistake, spending all my money away as a young bartender. You know, once you finally have a business and you're going to open up a bar, one thing I always recommend the younger bartenders, save your money, push it towards like your end goal. What was the last question, sorry?
The one thing, whether it's a tool or a communication that would just, you think, make things a lot easier for you?
I think right now in our community, obviously we've seen like, you know, like bars and restaurants getting a bit closer, which is nice. But like, I think we need to see a little bit more synergy with a lot of people because there's a lot of problems that I don't know how to solve. And I don't think in the F&B industry we'll know like, how can I reduce my aircon usage, or if I want to install a grey water tank in my bar, how can I go about it? How can I calculate the amount of power that's being used accurately in my bar? And like we saw it earlier with the guys from behind bars, you know, like that element of like design coming in, integrating with the bars, you know. I hope in the next like 5 to 10 years there's a bit more synergy with like engineers and even like people who do food science. You know, it's very distant away from bars and restaurants right now, and these people could help us a lot more. And obviously like working closer with farmers, and some farmers, like, you know, some farmers don't even know that bars or restaurants want to connect with them. So I think in the next few years we see a lot more synergy, not just in physical like drinks and food, but with people who can help us out. that'll be super cool. And one more thing is, like, you see every other industry, they rely so much on data. If you look at tech, fintech, you know how many people are coming through, how long they're staying there, what they're doing, how much they're spending. And I think we need a lot more data in the bars, you know, like, and accurate data that bar owners and bartenders can use to improve on our products. Because right now we have a lot of research, but it's mostly like surveys asking top bartenders, what do you think is the best selling product? So if we have a lot more like accurate data, it could help us out a lot as well, you know. And like right now what we're doing at the bar, we're trying to exile like sugar, like refined sugar. So we're obviously it's hard to escape like sweetness, but we try to use like honey and palm sugar, which is lower in GI, so it's just much better for you. Xylitol, you know, monk fruit. So we're still experimenting with that and like what kind of sugars work for fermentation. And it'll be really interesting to see like, oh, okay, if I make this drink, can a diabetic person have it without, you know? But right now it's just theory, you know, but if we work with a lot of different kind of groups, it could be a lot more interesting.
Cool, thank you very much.
Cheers, thank you.
So what's next?
What's next?
Are you going to have a 2.0? Are you going to have another outlet? You know, you've got a young team. How are you going to motivate them to keep going?
It's crazy because, like I always say, you know, I spent 10 years of my life and that goal was to open my own space. And once it happened, I had never thought of something above that. But I think the team is getting really strong right now. We are opening up sort of a R&D, like, not a space, R&D team. So, and then we are opening up a bigger, like, garden space, about 1,002 square feet. So I think the 2.0 for me, it's like, you know, how will bartenders change over the next few years? So like eventually if we can have bartenders like 3 days on shift, 2 days gardening, 1 day R&D, you know, and then understanding a lot of different aspects, I think that's where we want to sort of push our team towards. So I think 2020, that's sort of the things that we want to work